Welcome today to the Message of the Cross. This is Evangelist Jimmy Swaggart, along with Jim Woolsey, Carl Brown, John Rosenstern, Lorne Larson, Dr. Don Paul Gray, and Dave Smith. And Dr. Gray laid down the law to me that I should not refer to him as Dr. Gray.
That's right.
And but see, I'm a lot older than he is. So he can go only so far with that.
That's right.
And I forget sometimes. And but anyway, that's who he is.
In Dallas, they called me Pastor Don.
Pastor Don. Okay.
Or just Don is fine. I'm not your pastor.
He's giving us more instructions.
Yeah. Quick, grab the shovel.
I'm sorry I said anything. Yeah, I should have kept my mouth shut. Tomorrow, 5 o'clock a.m. sharp, Jim and I will be here, the Lord willing. And for the August Share-a-thon, and I'm believing that thousands of you have been asking the Lord what he would have you do. And I know that some of you already know. The Lord told you that a long time ago. And you've been so very, very faithful. And how we thank God for that. And we just went on a charter cable that covers the whole nation. I think it's 14 million homes. And we were on a part of it, but now we're on all of it, all across the nation. I think there's a little small part that it'll come online in just a few days, if not already. And what am I saying? I'm saying, and we saved quite a bit of money in the Los Angeles area because of that, how we thank the Lord for that. But that money went to pay for... What's the cities in Brazil?
São Paulo,
Brazil,
and
Rio de Janeiro in Brazil. I don't know why I have a little mental hang-up on remembering the names of those two cities. São Paulo is one of the largest cities in the world. They think it's about 50 million population, but they don't really know. Now you think of that. And the other one, Jim?
Rio de Janeiro
is smaller, but it's still a major city. And we don't cover the entirety of those two cities. We're on the largest cable system there, and it covers a wide swath of it. So we're thankful to be there. We just went on as well in one of the major outlets in Australia that covers, again, a large group of homes, several millions, to be frank with you. And so the money we saved in the other, it's gone toward this. I was questioning my people yesterday, because I looked at the amount, it'll be about the same as last month, $4,500,000 is about, in round numbers, what it will cost for airing over the cable systems, that's over satellites and over the stations and whatever the case. That does not, as you've heard me say any number of times, does not include any overhead whatsoever. It does not include payroll for, I've been saying that we have 309 people, but I was told the other day it's 320 some odd, something like that. Does not include the payroll for that, does not include the utilities, does not include equipment, does not include maintenance, does not include any of that. Mm. And we have to believe God for the whole thing. But what you give, starting in the morning, the Lord willing, does not include any overhead. We have to believe God for that to come in, and it always has. I just thank God for it so very, very much. And I pray just about every day of my life for each of you. I don't mean each of you because I don't know each of you. But collectively, I pray for you that God will bless you. Those of you who need employment, that he'll provide it. Who need better employment, and he will provide it. those of you who have small businesses, that he'll give you wisdom
yes.
as to how to operate those businesses. And those of you who live on a small fixed income, that he'll stretch it. God's able to do anything. So be praying about tomorrow. It's very, very, very important. And we're going to start today with Romans, as we the same passage we dealt with yesterday. We'll start with that, the 26th verse of the 12th chapter of the great book of Romans. When Phoebe took scrolls, I don't know if it was one scroll or two or three that contained the book of Romans, which had just been written by the Apostle Paul. I wonder, did she know, and I'm almost positive she didn't, did she know that in those scrolls that she was taking to Rome was the theology of the church? Did she know that? I think I can say without fear of contradiction that those scrolls that she had with her to take to Rome were the greatest, most significant, most important works that any human being ever handled in history.
Praise God.
I know that's quite a statement, but I believe it to be. You say, well, greater than the law, the Ten Commandments? Yes, because those things just pointed toward the new covenant. This was the new covenant that Phoebe had and was given to her by the Apostle Paul as he wrote it in Corinth, and it was being taken to the church in Rome. And no doubt there were copies of it made as well. And I just, you say, well, isn't that stretching it a little bit, saying it's the most? No, it's not. To be frank with you, I don't have the superlatives or the adjectives to properly express the vast significance of the great epistle of Paul the Apostle to the Romans. I don't think any human being does. Dr. Gray here, I tease him about this, but he hasn't earned PhD, but I think he'll agree with me that there's nothing that's more important as other things were, than this which God gave to the great apostle. And I am saved today because of it. You are saved
yes.
today because of it. Our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and we give God the praise and the glory. But this was the greatest work any human hand ever penned. And as God gave this to Paul, and it rounded out the new covenant. We'll start with the 26th verse of the 12th chapter, please, Jim.
As so all Israel shall be saved.
When the church age ends and the second coming commences, then Israel will accept Christ and be saved.
As it is written.
Isaiah 27:9 and 59:20 and 21.
There shall come out of Zion the deliverer.
Jesus Christ will be the deliverer. And I want to stop there for a moment.
Mm-hmm.
There is no deliverer but Christ. You see, man needs, he not only needs mercy, he needs grace, he needs forgiveness, but he needs deliverance.
Yes.
And there is only one that is stronger than the strong man. The strong man is Satan. Jesus is the stronger. He is stronger than the strong man. He delivers people. That's what mankind needs, is deliverance.
Amen.
I think I can say this without fear of contradiction, that every person who comes to Christ, who is born again, who is saved, they were also delivered at the time of their salvation.
Yes.
Right.
And I, you say, well, a little child, well, I'll have to leave that with the Lord. But at the same time, I know for sure that every adult, every teenager that comes to Christ has to not only experience forgiveness, but also deliverance. That's the reason Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives. Notice, he didn't say, lay hands on them and deliver them. Now, that's scriptural and proper, but that's not what he said. He said, preach deliverance.
Amen.
to the captives. And when we preach to you the cross, we're preaching deliverance.
Yes. Yes. Right.
Praise our God.
Brother Swigert, the great word for salvation, root word in the Greek, sozo, actually, I mean, it's translated saved. For by grace are you saved through faith, etc., etc. Throughout the New Testament, it's used. That word means to be protected, to be delivered, to be made whole, and to be healed. To be protected, delivered, healed, to be made whole. That's the word saved.
Well, deliverance has the idea of a door to a prison cell opening and a person being allowed to go out free.
Exactly. And in chapter 1, I think it's verse 4 or 5 of Galatians, Paul declares that the Son of God has delivered us, literally snatched us out of the setting that we were in. In salvation, we are transferred from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of God's dear Son.
You are a perfect example. And I know that everyone who gets saved is not delivered from drugs or alcohol, but millions are. But there are other sins.
Right.
And sin is such that even though it's not one of the vices, it still places a person in bondage.
Right. Remember that salvation produces freedom from the sin nature, which is the very core of all of man's problems.
Right.
We don't sin and become a sinner. We sin because that's what we are in our nature.
Right.
And so at salvation, as a man, woman, boy, or girl is baptized into Christ, this is where the power of the sin nature can be broken as a result of what Christ did for us at Calvary. So deliverance from sin is a result of what Christ did at the cross and the believing sinner's faith in that.
Amen.
They are delivered at that moment in time. It's done without their knowledge. It's done without their knowing anything about the process. God never requires that we learn something and then give it to us. We enter into something by faith, and then he teaches us what we have.
The person that is delivered, and as I said, every believer, every person who comes to Christ is delivered. And they might say, well, you know, I was not, alcohol was no problem for me, or gambling or drugs or whatever the case might be. But sin itself is a bondage.
Yes, sir.
Of any nature. I don't care what it is. Let me ask you this. The moment that a person is saved, at that moment they are completely and totally delivered.
Absolutely.
Yes.
But now, it doesn't mean that every one of these maledictions or problems fall off. Some do instantly. Some it's several weeks, months down the road.
Might even say years, Brother Swigert, to be honest.
Right.
Because while the fact of deliverance is there, the reality of deliverance has to be experienced by faith and grace, and we have to know what to place our faith in and allow God's grace to continually move through. This is a spiritual law that's been established in Scripture from the very beginning. In type and shadow, it was seen in the Old Testament when God told Israel, I've given you the land, now go take the land. Remove the enemies from the land.
And those enemies were not removed quickly.
In fact,
he told Joshua, you are old and stricken in years. There remains yet very much land to be possessed.
Correct. In Deuteronomy 7, he gives us the term little by little, speaking of the removal of the enemies.
Yeah.
Not that their dominion has not already been eliminated, but that now the Israelite was to go into his inheritance, see those that were there that didn't belong, and eliminate them by faith and trusting in God's power to do it. So that was the process. And he said very clearly, I will not allow the total elimination of all enemies at one point in time. If that was to happen, we would very quickly learn to live by flesh, and we would never learn dependence upon God in a daily basis.
Okay, you just hit on something that's extremely important. That's right. And the learning process of learning to trust Him does not come quickly, does not come easily, because we are so prone to fall back on religious flesh.
Correct.
So prone to fall back on it, thinking it's God's way, when in reality it's flesh. And if it's not Christ and the cross, it's flesh.
Yes, sir.
Right. And there is no place for sin except the cross.
Amen.
I mean, if we try to get rid of it any other way other than by the cross, we fail.
That's right.
It won't work.
Right.
And then that's what you need to understand. The only answer for sin, the overall answer for sin, the overriding answer for sin, the only answer for sin is the cross of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
It was there that that Christ atoned for all sin, past, present, and future, at least for those who will believe. And we need to get that in. You can't fast sin away.
Amen.
You can't do it. Fasting is scriptural, but you can't fast sin away. You cannot buy or purchase sin away. You can't do that with money. Won't work. There's only one answer for sin. That is the cross of Christ.
Amen.
That's the reason the modern church is in trouble today, is because it doesn't know that one truth that we've tried to deliver here in the last few moments, that the cross of Christ alone is the answer for sin, not 40 days of purpose,
right,
not 21 days of fasting. Those things may have their place. Some of them are not scriptural, some are, in their own manner and way. But I'm sorry, but the preacher can't lay hands on you and deliver you from these problems of sin. He can't do it. I got amused at hearing C.M. Ward once say, he said, you come up to me asking me to pray for you. And he said, take a look at me. My waist is up to my armpits. He said, if I could do anything, I'd do it for myself. But a preacher can't lay hands. I believe in laying on of hands. We lay hands on believers every Sunday at Family Worship Center. It's scriptural. But you cannot lay hands on somebody and all of a sudden they have no more sin problems.
That's right.
The cross of Christ alone is the solution, the answer for sin. There is no other.
Brother Swigert, we must go to the cross for deliverance. We must go to the cross for deliverance and for victory, because that is the only place God can meet with man and man can meet with God.
That's right.
It's the only place that God himself addressed sin, every sin there is. And there at the cross is the only place. It's not through some effort of our own, because all of those roads lead to defeat. And that's why we must go to the cross. We must find out everything we can about Jesus and what he did on the cross and keep our faith there so that the Holy Spirit can bring us this great victory for which Christ died.
See, scores of Christians think, if I was as strong as Brother so-and-so or Sister so-and-so, I would have it made. Looking at it totally wrong. Our personal strength or the lack thereof has nothing to do with it,
right.
Period.
Right.
It's our faith.
That's it.
Our faith in Christ and what Christ did for us at the cross. See, the cross is something that took place 2,000 years ago, but has continuing results, and continuing results that will never be discontinued. Understand that. Let's say it again. The cross of Christ, something that happened 2,000 years ago nearly, and it has continuing positive results, never stopping, and will never stop with those continued positive results. In other words, it is just as apropos, just as I want to use the word powerful. That's not what I want, though. Just as effective today as it was 2,000 years ago when he uttered on the cross, it is finished.
Praise God.
Just as powerful.
Yes.
It scares Satan just that much now as it did then and ever shall. For there is no end to it. And when we say the cross, we're not talking about a wooden beam on which Jesus died. We're talking about what he there did, what he there accomplished, what he there brought forth, the great victory he there won. You can read about it in Colossians chapter 2, verses 10 through 15, where he triumphed over every principality and power, and he atoned for all sin.
Yes.
Glory to God, nailed it to the cross.
Hallelujah. Talk about repentance. How does that figure into what you're sharing there?
There's got to be repentance on the part of a sinner coming to Christ.
Or the Christian.
But that repentance for the sinner, look at that verse, for the unconverted, the unredeemed, that repentance is not repenting of every sin. They can't do that. That's foolishness.
Right.
It's to repent and confess I am a sinner.
Right.
And
right.
I need a redeemer. Now, when it comes to the Christian now, we do confess our singular sins,
amen,
whatever they may be. We do confess, Lord, I failed you. I did thus and so. That's confession, and it's apropos for a Christian to do that.
Can the power of the cross work without repentance?
No, I don't think so.
I don't either. No. I think that's the problem with the church today.
Well, the church...
We bypass repentance.
What we're trying to teach here, Don, the church as a whole, they've never heard it. They don't know what you're talking about. Respecting the cross of Christ and sanctification. They don't understand that.
Right, yeah.
Now you ought to know.
Yeah.
And they don't understand it. So I don't think it's as much a abject rejection or refusal. They just don't know. But unbelief, well, once they hear, this thing has been going out now over the airwaves all around the world for several years now. Now it becomes not ignorance, but it becomes unbelief.
Let's deal with...
Or rebellion.
Well, it's the same thing.
Yeah. Let's deal with this thought as well, Brother Swigert. It's important to understand that repentance and deliverance are two different things altogether.
That's right.
Right.
Repentance, by definition, simply means that I make a choice to go 180 degrees in the other direction. Now, there are Christians that don't know the cross, that don't understand the power of the cross.
They repent and are forgiven, but they're not delivered.
Right. You turn 180 degrees because you know that what you did was wrong. The Holy Spirit within has convicted you of sin. That is a safeguard that is applicable to every truly born-again believer, especially to Spirit-filled people. Conviction is healthy. We say, Lord, I've done the wrong thing. And we turn from our sin. But the problem within is that the desire to carry out that sin comes from the heart. It comes from the mind and the soul, the spirit of inside a man. Jesus said, sin stems from the heart. So we can repent from the heart, truly, honestly repent and of a failure
and
in our
not
lives,
be delivered.
And not be delivered,
yes,
from the core problem. And this is where the work of the Holy Spirit is so vital, and the understanding of the cross. We can't remove that wrong desire from inside of us. Repentance, or turning away from it, doesn't remove it. Only the work of God's Spirit working in us by faith and grace, faith in what Christ did for us at Calvary, grace, the moving and operation of the Holy Spirit, the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, now is able to take that believer, and as he continues to walk away from that sin, that desire, he begins to remove that wrong desire because our faith is in the right object. The way that we get rid of doing the wrong thing is to have the heart changed from wanting the wrong thing. This is what God did. You mentioned my transition. The first 3 months, God took out the desire for alcohol. I'm not an alcoholic. The Holy Spirit removed that desire.
Right.
He took the desire out of me for cocaine and drugs and cigarettes and all that. I don't have that desire. If there's no desire on the inside of me, you can't tempt me with that because there's not. And that's the work of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. It's only the work of the Holy Spirit. And it only works in us as our faith is centered appropriately. Now, one other thing I'd add to this, and we need to talk about this as we go. You can repent, place your faith in the cross, and start that journey away from that action or attitude and fail in again.
Oh, yes.
You, say that again?
Oh, yes. You could.
Happens
you could,
every day.
Right.
Oh,
you could face an enemy, fail. Ask God to forgive you, repent, start walking away, place your faith in Christ and the cross. And because there's a learning curve, there's times that this that's in us is going to take a little while for the Holy Spirit to work out of us. We could be tempted and fail again and find ourselves back here where we have to repent and turn. And that needs to be understood.
Yeah, but religious, it's not a question of one here and there. I would greatly suspect that every single believer faces that.
Yeah, in most cases, that's going to happen. Yeah, exactly.
Now, it may not be for the whole gamut. It may be just one thing.
Surely.
It doesn't matter. It's still sin. It's wrong.
But we don't change this process once we get on it.
No, the fault is ours, not the cross.
So repentance is always required when we fail.
Mm-hmm.
But when we turn our back to that failure and we look for the answer relative to what's going to change me, our eyes must fall on Calvary and what Christ there did. Our faith must be resting in Him. And you are guaranteed the work of the Holy Spirit, the grace of God, to keep working in you until that desire is gone.
There are two aspects of the Holy Spirit. You shall receive power after that the Holy Spirit has come upon you. That's to help us do the work of the Lord. And like where you're here right now, and any believer, it doesn't matter. You say, well, I'm not a preacher, so I don't really see how the Holy Spirit, could benefit that much. Let me tell you, if you're a truck driver, the Holy Spirit will help you to be a better truck driver.
Yes, indeed.
If you're a plumber, the Holy Spirit will help you to be a better plumber. If you're a lawyer, the Holy Spirit will help you be a better lawyer, on and on and on. And to think that we don't need Him, that's about the most ridiculous, utterly foolishness that one could utter. And so it's power to help us carry forth the work of the Lord. But then you go to Romans 8 and 2, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. That is to help us live this life. We've got millions of Christians that are being used of the Lord right now. They love God. They're being used of God, and rightly so, but are failing at the same time. Failing tremendously so, and they're not able to get victory over that problem, whatever that problem is. And it's because they're trying to do it themselves. They're not looking to Christ and the cross. They're looking, and going back to what Lauren said, and if you think that we're saying you have your faith right and it's smooth sailing from here on out, there's never another problem. That's not the case. Satan will never quit. He'll never give up. And look at Simon Peter. One day, he's walking down the street in Jerusalem toward the temple. The street is lined with the sick of every description. Blinded eyes, lame legs, lepers, you name it. And just his shadow causes these people to be healed by the power of God.
Yes.
But then fast forward, you go what's the name of the city? Antioch. Go to Antioch. And you see Peter failing. Here's the man whose very shadow had scores healed by the power of God. And here he is failing because you say, well, I don't understand. I thought we'll never fail again. Well, no, that's not correct. And so did that mean that he was not real whenever his shadow was healing people? No, it was real. But Peter resorted to the flesh, and it's so easy to do that. And when you do that, you're going to fail. I don't care who you are. And that's what he did.
That's right.
Stay there, thank God.
What do we say to the detractors out there that the illustration Lauren just gave a few minutes ago and yourself regarding the failure after deliverance, after forgiveness, and they don't understand the message of the cross? What do we say to them when they say what we have just said is giving people a license to sin?
They don't have to have a license. They'll sin without it.
Right. But what they do is they do not deal with sin in the church because they say that's going to cause
don't throw a truth out, you don't eliminate something that's biblical because you're afraid something might happen. That's not correct. We all, every single one of us, has had to rely upon God's grace and his willingness to lend mercy and forgiveness in the same area again and again and again. That doesn't mean that I wanted to fail in that area. That's a very wrong premise.
Right.
When Christians fail, I don't think there's any person that's a true believer that gets up in the morning and says, oh, Lord, I just can't wait to fail you today. That's not the inward bent of the new creation man.
Let's look at this for a moment. You've got millions of Christians out there, including preachers, whatever the case. They live in a perpetual state. They wouldn't call it that. They wouldn't even think of it that. But their attitude is wrong. Their faith is wrong. Whatsoever is not of faith is sin, Paul said. Mm-hmm. And they're in a perpetual state of failure. Am I making any sense?
Oh, yes, sir.
You follow what I'm saying? Okay, is that person saved?
Absolutely.
Yes, they are saved.
If their faith is in the Savior.
Right, that's right. But it hinders their spiritual growth. It causes them all kind of problems. They don't walk in victory. And it's a, and I think I can say this, it's a state of condemnation.
There has to be a sense of guilt anytime we fail.
Okay, that's what I'm, but they're not committing overt acts of sin. It is a problem in their spirit. This is not just one here and there. There are millions that fall into this category.
Right.
Every person out there that's trusting in something other than Christ and the cross is living in a state of sin.
And whatsoever is not of faith
is sin.
Yes, that's right. That's why this lifestyle of faith in the cross is called a battle of faith.
Thank you.
It's a warfare. In other words,
we wrestle not against flesh and blood.
It's not the battle of me trying to get my willpower stronger or strengthen myself and my personal disciplines. It's my faith remaining in the only source of my victory in Christ and what he did on the cross.
Okay, that person that we're talking about that's living in a state of sin, they don't think of it as sin. They don't look at it that way as sin. And they're not repenting of it.
Right.
But sometimes the Holy Spirit will be able, he's always trying to pull them to the place that they'll see their condition and their situation and then will repent.
Right.
But sometimes that takes years.
Well, that's because, Brother Swigert, we look at the bondages and Christ defeated sin. He defeated the system of this world. He defeated Satan. But when you come to the biggest culprit of them all, self is trying to get to is self. Now, self is neutral, but if self has its faith in the wrong object, then self is doing some kind of effort that doesn't please God. Every pastor, every preacher, every evangelist, every teacher that gets up and says, yes, I believe what Brother Swigert and those brethren are saying, that the answer is found in Christ, and the means is the cross by which he can bring us the victory, but we've got to do our part. Then starts the journey in the message of teaching, this is what we do. There is your problem. Self wants to take the supremacy.
The add-ons.
And get the glory from it at the end.
But millions of Christians are living in a state of sin, a failure, and they don't agree that they are. Every one of us here have seen the people that we've felt and believe with all of our heart they were doing wrong. Their attitude was wrong. Their action was wrong. They don't think so.
Right. Self-righteousness is a blinder. You can't see it.
Yeah.
It's just one of the examples that rises up. And that's why it's important to note that when there is a problem in your life, don't ignore it. And most of the time, that's the flower from the root.
But a lot don't consider that that is a problem. They don't consider that there is a problem.
Yes.
You question people out there about the cross and about their faith being in Christ and the cross, and they would not agree with you at all that even though they don't know anything about it, that they're living in a state of sin.
Yes, that's correct. They wouldn't see what God wants us to see. Before we can be healed, before we can be delivered, before God can change us, we've got to see and admit our condition and turn to Christ and the cross for help.
I was reading behind George Williams once. He was an English preacher. He was more of a writer than a preacher. And the Lord gave the man some insight, especially on the Old Testament. And he made the statement, and this was years ago I read this, that we need to come to the place that we repent not only of the bad things we do, but the good things we're doing. Mm-hmm. Because we're depending on those good things.
Right.
See, for righteousness.
Our faith is in that instead of Christ
and the cross. We've got a break. We'll be right back. In our conversation respecting this which Paul wrote concerning the deliverer, we know that Jesus Christ is the deliverer. He is the one, he does it through the Holy Spirit. Everything done on this planet by God has been done by the Holy Spirit, with the exception of our Lord's birth and life and crucifixion and resurrection and ascension. But the Holy Spirit superintended all of that totally. But we're learning, I think, a little bit about sin. Sin is far more than cigarettes and alcohol and pornography and drugs. It's far, far more than that. And those things are sin. Don't misunderstand. But sin, we quoted it just a little bit ago, whatsoever is not of faith is sin. That's a strong term.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, a strong term. Now, you say, well, how can a person then, they're living in a state of the flesh, their faith is, if they have faith, it's in the wrong thing, and they're living in a state of sin. We're talking about born-again believers. If that person is born again, the Lord doesn't throw us over. Understand that he's merciful and gracious and kind. If he wasn't, I wouldn't be here. None of us would be, to be frank and plain Amen. With you, ladies and gentlemen.
Amen.
And even though sin covers a far wider swath than we realize, I mean far wider, but the grace of God is greater.
Yes.
And we thank God for his grace. And he makes intercession for the saints constantly. The very presence of Christ at the right hand of the Father guarantees the intercession on our behalf. I want to make a statement here, and if I'm wrong in it, I may be a little far-fetched. I want you to tell me. Whenever the day ends, a person who is trusting Christ, even though they may be wrong about some things, whatever the case, they do not go to bed with sins against them. What do you all think? Because the intercession of Christ takes care of it. Now, I'm not talking about people who are in a state of sin and know they are and are continuing on in rebellion. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about everyday life and living.
I think that you're correct. And I would quote 1 John.
His mercies are new every morning.
Well, let's go to scripture that deals specifically with that. 1 John 1 and 7 deals with the constant flow of blood that cleanses as a result of simple faith. And if that's not the case, listen, there's not a man on this dais, there's not a person watching us and listening to us right now that's in a state of perfection. If the blood of Christ is not applied to their lives by faith, they could not have a relationship with God. We're not condoning sin. We've recognized the only way that God could have a relationship with any man, and that's to send his son to die so that the blood could be applied to those whose lives are trusting in him.
Right.
And we're not perfect, so we have to consider that this is true. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, that simply deals with our faith, then we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Christ is constantly cleansing us, constantly cleansing, constantly cleansing.
Whenever Jesus, whenever he was washing the disciples' feet, Peter said, "No, wash my head, my hands, feet, and everything else." And the Lord said, "No, you don't need your head washed or your hands washed." The head was salvation, meaning that the believer doesn't have to get saved all over again if the believer fails. There's no such thing as that. Hands, it means that's what we do. Well, Jesus has done it, so that's out. Our feet is our everyday walk. We walk before God, and it's our way we live, and live for God, whatever the case. And the feet need washing. We need, it's symbolically speaking, it's not right, that you right. wash your feet and it's going to cure you of sin. It doesn't. But it means our daily walk before God. And we need that thing that Lauren just mentioned, that ever-cleansing flow of the precious blood of Christ, and our faith guarantees that.
That's what our faith does.
Can I emphasize something? I'm sorry. Go ahead, Brother Jim.
Yes, I want to point out the answer to your question, Brother Swigert, is in part what we are in Christ right now. See, many think, well, okay, Brother Swigert, I'm going to put my faith in Christ as my source and the cross as the means to receive this victorious, abundant life and living. And then someday I'll become an overcomer. That is wrong.
Right, wrong.
We are overcomers right now.
Right now.
I can go to bed tonight, rest my head on the pillow and know that I'm an overcomer.
Because of my faith
in Christ overcoming all those things already at the cross. I don't have to try to overcome them. I leave it up to him to bring me the power of the Holy Spirit to overcome. I am an overcomer, and right. I can praise right. him for it, and That's I thank right. him for that, and for him making that possible to me through the cross.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, that's true positionally. That may not be true if you had a fuss with your wife and you didn't settle it before you went to bed.
Well, that's what we're talking about.
It depends on your heart in that condition.
But you see the point of the difference. Positionally, we are in right relationship with God, and we can go to bed at night.
Conditionally, you aren't.
Right.
If we've
left something unfinished, and sometimes I've done it.
Yeah.
Sometimes I've left issues unfinished.
Now, it's the condition of your heart in that fuss with your spouse.
Mm-hmm.
If my heart was remaining without the reaction of the sin nature, I might have a disagreement or a contradiction with somebody, but I ask the Lord, please keep my heart right.
Sure.
I'm going to meet this person. I know they're going to have something negative to say. Would you please, Lord, be my overcomer in this situation. Keep my heart right.
Right.
You can have an intense discussion with someone if you keep your heart right, but that doesn't mean you're always going to keep it right.
Yeah.
But little by little, God is going to give you strength in that so that you remain calm and don't overreact, because every day in our walk in this life, we're interfacing with other people.
Right.
And the sin nature is dominating in their lives.
Yeah.
And
I don't have much problem with other people. I have problems with me.
Well, right. That's it. That's my heart. I've got to keep my heart right, and only the Lord can do that.
There was another thought I wanted to share, Brother Swigert. You know, I think in my life, in trying to understand what God wants to do and what he has done, there's something I'm learning as I've grown older, and that is the emphasis on brokenness and having a contrite spirit.
It's very strong.
And I've learned the more that I stay at that level, to the Lord and to my fellow brethren, that I try to be amenable to what the Holy Spirit is saying, whether he's speaking through the scriptures or whatever. And I mentioned earlier about repentance. If there's something that we know that we have done, whereby the Holy Spirit has convicted us, yes, we need to repent to the Lord and maybe to the person that we've offended. But just living life daily with that sense of humility, of asking God, I was never known to be the humble type, Brother Swigert. I was rather known to be kind of cocky.
No.
I was. I asked my brothers, I'll tell you. But I do think these last few years, the Lord has chastised me a little bit, and I'm pursuing that. Another phrase is godly sorrow. When there's things that we've done wrong, if there's godly sorrow in our lives, the Lord is quick to repent and are quick to forgive us and to help us to overcome those things.
To this man will I look, he that is of a broken and contrite spirit and trembles at my word. That's what he said through Isaiah. To this man, what you just got through saying, to this man will I look, he who is of a broken and contrite spirit and who trembles at my word. And there are no perfect believers. They don't exist. There's a perfect Christ.
Yes. Thank
God, he exists. And but our faith in him keeps us in him.
Yes.
Right. This discussion of position and condition is important because I am, as a result of being a believer, for as many as believed on him, to them gave he the power to become the Son of God.
Yes.
That's not powers and the idea of dunamis. It's legal right. I am legally a child of God. I'm adopted. That's a legal work. That's my position. But you know what? I also have a condition. Now, I have a position and I have a condition. There's just one me. I'm just one person. I am both. That, if my faith is in Christ, I am one who is in Christ. I'm a new creation in Christ Jesus. I've been granted the power of relationship with God. The blood of Christ is applied to my life. And at the same time, I have a condition that needs repairing. I have a condition that needs increasingly to be conformed into the image of Christ.
Yes.
Here's the ongoing thing. I'm not one or the other. I'm both. I have to recognize this. Our friends in the Grace Revolution say, well, just recognize your position and you don't even have to think about your condition. We don't teach that. We don't preach that. Somebody listening to us today will say, oh, you're teaching unconditional eternal security. No, we're not either. We're recognizing and basing our relationship with God based on our position in faith. But this position is there not to ignore my condition, but to bring me the means by which my condition, little by little, step by step, line upon line, precept upon precept, might be brought up to that, closer and closer to that position I've been granted as a result of grace and faith. So my position is by faith and grace, faith in the cross, and my condition is affected by faith in the cross, which brings the Holy Spirit. The only reason the Holy Spirit can work on my condition is because I have my position. This is it. So we have to understand that I'm not either or. I have both working in me, and God's plan has made provision to give me the right position and to always attend to my condition. It's both things going on at the same time, not either or.
Okay, then the question is how? Now, here's how. Walk in the Spirit on a daily basis. That's, you are an overcomer.
That's
now the how. Now, what is walking in the Spirit?
Your faith in Christ, what Christ did for you at the cross and maintained in Christ.
Right.
And what he did at the cross, it never is to leave that object.
That is walking in the Spirit.
Right. Right.
Nothing less and nothing more. That is walking in the Spirit. I deny self. This is a daily thing because I want the continuing results of that event that took place there, that great victory. I deny self. I take up the cross and follow Jesus. So today, I'm walking in the Spirit as long as I maintain my faith in Christ, and that finished work, it was all sufficient for my walk today.
Amen.
And that's walking Amen. In the Spirit.
My mother used to say that, you know, a person can't help a bird flying over his head, but he doesn't have to let that bird build a nest on his head.
That's good.
But, you know, this, what Jim has just said, now let's take this to the next stage. Understanding that it's my responsibility to walk in the Spirit, understanding I have this position granted to be my faith, and I recognize, and that's what keeps me humble, Dr. Gray, is that I recognize that I don't deserve this position. It's been granted as a result of my faith. And so with my faith here secured in who Christ is and what he's done, I'm progressively learning. And now watch. And there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. So now, even though I recognize there's still things that need to be changed in me, and I'm sorry, there's things that take more than one day. So I'm going to go to bed with some things in me tonight that God is still fixing. God is still changing. But that doesn't mean I go to bed under condemnation. That doesn't mean I don't walk in justification. And that doesn't mean that I'm embracing sin. I'm embracing Christ. And the process is he's granted me a position and he's moving me closer and closer to his condition.
No true believer wants sin. Right. Sin is awful. It is horrible. And the flesh may want something
right.
That's ungodly, that's wrong, but the real man, the inner man, doesn't want it. And it is despicable in every capacity, sin is. And the longer we live for God, the more despicable it becomes. And that's the way it ought to
right.
be.
Yes, sir.
But I do believe this. I believe if those who watch this particular, watch this network, and especially this program here. If you have doubts about what we're teaching, get on your face before God and ask the Holy Spirit, ask the Lord to show you what is right and what is wrong. He'll do that. He'll always respond to a sincere, honest heart.
Amen.
And if you ask him, Lord, is this right, what they're teaching or whatever else, he'll give you the answer. You'll know. You'll find out. And it's a fearful thing, sin against light. I mean, it's bad enough to sin, period, but to sin against light. And what do you mean light? I mean, If what we're teaching is right, and I know it is, I don't have to really quibble over it, I know it is, well then, if you reject it, that's a serious thing. You could lose your soul. I'm not saying you will, but you could lose your soul. Because once we set ourselves on a pathway of error, the error compounds itself. It begins to become more and more and more and more. And a little leaven will ultimately leaven the whole lump. The whole thing will be rotten and wretched. And I firmly believe that the Lord is sending this message to the world.
Amen.
And to the entirety of the church all
Amen.
Over the world.
Amen.
I believe that with all of my heart. Stop and think a moment. How could anyone demean, denigrate, degrade the cross of Jesus Christ?
Right, right.
How could you? Well, I believe we've got to do our part. Well, you mean to say what Jesus did at the cross is not enough?
Yes, it is.
You mean to say that he left some things undone? Do you realize what a terrible insult that is to Christ? No, ladies and gentlemen, when he said it is finished, I meant the whole thing pertaining to sin was finished. The fallen sons of Adam's lost race now have the door open that whosoever will Praise may God. Come and take of the water of life Praise freely.
Yes.
Praise God. And this is your soul. And not only that, but this is the greatest life that anyone could ever
Amen.
Live.
Amen.
When my salvation no longer depends on Jimmy Swaggart, it depends on Christ
Praise
and
God.
What he did at the cross. A big load lifted off me.
Yes.
You know, I've got to do this. If I don't do it, I'll lose my soul. No. And he is our life. He is our source. He is our victory. He is our deliverance. The Lord Jesus Christ is everything.